Good morning. In the last class, we had spoken about the pulse amplitude modulation, which is a natural technique for sampling. And we spoke about the various equations, that is at the transmitting side, how to sample and time domain equation for the sampled signal and the frequency domain equation for the sampled signal. And then at the receiver side, how to reconstruct the original signal back from the samples. Again, we went through the reconstruction filters and all that. And the conclusion was we saw pulse amplitude modulation is more prone to noise because the PAM signal, even if it is flat top sampling, we have natural sampling and flat top sampling. In natural sampling, the head of the pulses would remain in the same shape as the message. In flat top sampling, you would have the head of the pulses completely flat. In the sense, there wouldn't be any deviation. Once the pulse takes a sample at a particular amplitude, it will remain constant at that amplitude for the whole duration of the pulse. That is flat top sampling. And we also saw how we could get flat top sampling by first sampling using impulses. So we take ideal sampling through impulses and then we extend that impulse sample for a short time duration by passing it through a system with impulse response h of t. So we said it can be a filter or any system which has some impulse response h of t. The job of that system is to convert the impulses into pulses. So we discussed something like this and we derived the equations based on that assumption. Okay, but please remember, whenever we do this practically, we always generate pulses. It's difficult for us to generate impulses. So normally we always generate pulses only when we do this practically. Okay. And the major problem with pulse amplitude modulation, as we discussed, is what? That it is more prone to noise. With all the strict requirements of magnitude and phase responses, it is still very prone to noise. And we can't get very good performance as compared to baseband transmission in PAM. So basically, we try to use PAM more often for time division multiplexing rather than any other scheme. With this, let's move on to understanding what is time division multiplexing or TDM. TDM is basically used. It is another form of multiplexing. We had already used FDM in our amplitude modulation techniques. When we studied amplitude modulation, we spoke about FDM, the frequency division multiplexing. This is the second version of multiplexing, the time division multiplexing. And as you can see, you can expect the time slots, time would be divided into slots, and I'll be sending different signals in different time slots. Say, for example, I have a signal. We'll consider a signal like this. And let's say this is pulse amplitude modulated signal. Okay, so I have pulses at regular intervals of time. Let me consider this as signal M1 of t. Okay, and this is sampled at regular intervals, say T1, T2, so on. Let's say we have another signal. Something like this. And even this is what? Sampled. Even this is sampled. So I have pulses at all the sample values. Okay, so I'm just sampling this signal also. Let me consider this as message 2. Now I can multiplex these two signals and combine them to occupy a single channel by sending different samples at different instants of time. So, for example, if I have say if I call this sample S1, S2 of the upper signal, S3, S4, these are the samples. Let me call these samples as Y1, Y2, so on. These are the samples of the second signal. Now, in the combined multiplex signal, how would it be? You'll have the combination of this message as well as the second message. So it depends on what amplitude you have chosen. If I have chosen amplitudes for the first and second messages like this, you will see during time T1, sample S1 will be passing to the output, and during the next time slot, the sample Y1, whatever is the sample, so S1 goes here, the sample Y1 comes here. And again, during the third time slot, the sample S2 comes here. So this is the sample of the sine wave or the upper wave. So this is S2. And in the next time slot, that of this triangular wave comes here. So the triangular wave is something like this. This sample comes here. So you see Y2. Like this, I have given both the signals to be transmitted in two different time slots. I'm mixing up these two signals and sending. Okay, so this is how you represent the time division multiplexed signal. Okay, so each sample, the upper PAM samples will come alternatively. And in between them, we'll have the lower PAM samples, the triangular PAM samples. So continuously, the time is divided and occupied by these two samples. This is how we do time division multiplexing. Okay.
Ma'am, could you please explain it again?
Yeah. I'll show you a wider picture so it is clearer for you. Let me consider one signal like this, M1, okay, and I am first sampling that signal. So I'm going to take natural samples, let me say. I'm going to take natural samples of this signal, okay. So this is the first signal, and let's call these samples as S1, S2, S3, S4. There are four samples in the upper signal. Now I have a second signal, M2 of T. This signal is something like this. Okay, the shape of the signal. Now I am sampling this signal. You notice how I am sampling. I am going to take samples of these signals, Y1. I am sampling at a point of time which is not, or where I have zero levels in the upper. See, wherever I have zero in the upper message, at that point I am sampling the second signal. I am taking samples of the second signals wherever I don't have the first signal. See, first signal is present from here to here. Here it is zero. Here to here it is present, and here it is zero. So just consider all those times when the first signal was zero, and there you take the sample of second signal. That means you're sampling the second signal also at the same rate, but you're sampling the second signal at different times. So whenever, in whichever time the first signal is sampled, there the second signal value is zero. And whenever the first signal value is zero, there the second signal is present. It is those samples are present. All these places are where the second signal is present. Okay. So this is how you're going to do the sampling. You have two messages now. Now your job is to multiplex them or combine both the messages. So if you want to combine these two messages, the simplest way of doing it is, somebody has unmuted yourself, please mute it. See here, during, mark all these time slots. I'm just marking these time slots. Okay. Anyway, so during this first time slot, let me call it T1, the first message sample comes to the output. So all you have to do is you have to retrace the shape of the first message. So the first message was something like this, and you retrace the shape of the second message also. Okay, let me say this was the second message, and I'll show you a neater diagram later. So during time T1, the sample of the first message is sent in the output line. Okay, whatever was the first message, S1 will be sent completely. This sample will be sent. And during time T2, the second message sample, which is like this, the triangular wave is something like this. So the second message sample is sent during time T2. Again, during time T3, the first message sample. So from here to here, I have the first message. Okay. This is the sample of the first message. And during time T4, the next time slot, the sample of the second message. Whatever, however the second message looks, that sample. During time T5, the next time period, sample of the first message again. The first message is here. That's why I told you, trace both the message wave shapes. So alternatively, I'll have the first and second message sent to the output line. So the first message is sent in T1, T3, T5, the second message is sent in T2, T4, T6. So whatever is the shape of the second message, this is sample Y3 of the second message. Then again, I have to send sample of the first message. So this is how the combined or multiplexed signal looks when we have two different messages. Okay. So this is just for two messages. Imagine the same thing could be done for n different messages. I can have n input messages, and all of them will be sampled. All of them will be multiplexed using a commutator. So let's try to analyze this circuit. I think the circuit is not so very clear here. I think this is a bit better. You see, there are n message inputs, 1, 2, so on till n. And remember, I have to pass the message signals through a low-pass anti-aliasing filter. So the message signals have to be sent through a low-pass anti-aliasing filter initially, so as to avoid aliasing effect by strictly limiting the band of the message signal. The message signal should be strictly band limited, then aliasing effect is avoided. That seeping in of the message into the next one. One part of the message will extend to the next one, and because of that, you'll have distortion. That is aliasing effect, and that will be avoided by using anti-aliasing low-pass filters for all the message signals initially. Once this is done, Usually we do a PAM also. We sample each of the signals. Even without doing a PAM also, you can directly. So I can just have all the message signals as it is, even without having a PAM. Say I'll just take both the message signals, and in the multiplex signal, I'll just split the time slots. Okay, so I'll just split the time T1, T2, T3, T4, so on. And I told you, let's trace the shape of this message. Let's trace the shape of the second message. Time T1, first message, should be transmitted. Time T2, second message. Again, time T3, first message. Right? Time T4, second message. So, depending on the shape of the messages, you just take that particular message component and pass it. So here, but usually in a practical system, we first sample them and then do TDM. Okay. Here we have directly taken it to the various segments of the commutator. Remember, each segment of the commutator can carry different messages. So segment one here carries message M1, segment two, M2, so on. Segment N will carry the nth input message signal MN. Now, this commutator segment, what happens? It has a brush and a rotor. So this is a rotatory one, and in the end it will have a brush. Every time this brush comes into contact with one segment, it will take the value on that segment and transmit it to the output line. So this is your output line, okay? And this is the rotary present, and there is a brush here. Every time this brush comes into contact with one particular segment, whatever message is there on that particular segment, it will make a direct connection to the output line and it will transmit it on the output line. Okay. And this brush along with the rotor is rotated at a quick rate. You use a clock and you try to rotate this brush. So for time T1, it is in contact with segment 1. For time T2, it will come in contact with segment 2, and then it will be taking the message M2 directly to the output. During time T3, it will come in contact with segment 3, then it will be taking message M3 to the output, and during the time instant N, TN, it will come in contact with segment N, where the nth input message is coming. And it will transmit that nth input directly to the output line. So what I mean to say is, given any signals, you can have n different messages possible. You can go on sending n different messages. Each can be sent on different segments of the commutator. Okay. And you can have this rotor moving so fast that for fixed time durations, it will be in contact with one segment, where it will take the value of that segment and send it on the output line. So on the output line, for one short time duration, message M1 will be present. For the next time duration, message M2 will be present. For the third time duration, M3. Like that, I can go on having n different messages being sent. So this will be the multiplexed signal. Is this clear? Once that is done, you see, we have to modulate these pulses. You have to have some kind of modulation on these pulses. We can't send the baseband pulses directly on the channel. So here we are going to modulate the pulses. Either we'll have pulse amplitude modulation, pulse duration, or pulse width modulation, or pulse position. You can have We have other techniques also, pulse code modulation, delta modulation. You have different types of pulse modulation techniques. You'll use any one of them, modulate this multiplexed pulse. The final multiplexed pulse will be modulated. Then it will be transmitted on the communication channel. Without modulation, remember, the distance reached will be very less. the range is less, distortion, noise is high, so many problems. So modulation is a must. Here, instead of modulating individual signals like how we did in FDM, do you remember the FDM block diagram? Every message we would modulate separately. SSB modulation we did for all the messages. In FDM, the signal looked something like this. FDM, each message was modulated and it was shifted in different bands of frequency using different carrier values. So this signal was in F1, this was in F2, like this, F3. So we have different signals existing in different frequency bands, that is FDM. Here, we are modulating the combined or multiplexed signal. So we are saving on the circuitry. There, every individual signal had to be modulated and then combined, added. Here, every individual signal is first combined and then modulated. Then it is sent on the communication channel here. And at the receiver side, I have to demodulate. So I have the pulse demodulator circuitry and the clock pulses which are input at the modulator end and the demodulator end should be synchronized. Okay. And the decommutator, you see the commutator here, which will take samples of each message and send it on the transmission line. The decommutator just does the opposite job. Whatever it receives here, for every short time duration, it will send it to different segments. So what it receives, it will send on segment S1 for a time duration T1. Then it will send it on segment S2 for time duration T2, like that. So whatever it is going to receive, it will just take the individual pulses for different time duration and it will pass it on to the different segments. Now, at each segment, when they get their particular pulse sample, they'll use a low pass filter to get the final message. So the final demultiplexed message M1, M2, whatever we had sent, we'll get it after sending the received pulses through low pass filters. And please remember, this is a continuous process. It's not that it will take only one sample of all the messages, send it once and stop. No. So once it takes a sample of this message at this time, it may again come back to this message after some time. In between, it is filled up with other messages. Again, after the same amount of time, it will get the next sample of this message. So you'll be getting different samples of a message at fixed instants of time or at fixed time differences. And in between, it will be taking samples of other messages. This will happen repetitively and you notice that you can think there may be distortion because the in-between portion of the message we are missing. If I get one sample here, I'm getting the next sample here, the next here. So what happens to the wave shape in between? This can be reconstructed effectively if we do sampling at the Nyquist rate. So remember, anything higher than the Nyquist rate, if you sample signals at greater than or equal to twice the message bandwidth, 2 FM or 2W, you'll be able to get back the complete shape of the message using only the limited samples. That is the advantage of TDM. I need not send the whole message. I'll be saving on power. I'll be saving on circuitry, like cost, everything. But even then, I'll get back the shape of the message properly, because we have efficient reconstruction techniques. But it is possible only when you sample at a rate higher than the Nyquist rate. Is that clear? So this is time division multiple.